Amen. I thought about titling this message, "It's Time to Go," but I thought you might have met. I thought everybody would have got up and left. I didn't know. But one thing's for sure, I believe we've reached a crossroads at this church and many churches around the nation. I think we've come to a stop sign and we've paused for the cause, so to speak. As a matter of fact, we looked right, left, considered God's will, and now we must not sit and be idle, but we should rather put the pedal to the metal and say, "Let's go, baby, let's go," all right? Yeah. And so that's what we need to do. Now, somebody says, "Now that's the missionary's job to go." Well, yes it is, but the Bible says we're all missionaries for Christ. And we all should be going into the world. Now, I hope you'll go, you know, across the street, around the world, short-term, long-term missions. But I hope that you'll do this, especially in your neighborhoods, with your neighbor, with your friends, with your family. I pray that you will just go. You know, Matthew 28:19, it says, "Therefore, go ye, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost." The first word of that great commandment is to go, right? Mark 16:15 said unto them, "Go ye into all the world." What else are we supposed to do? Preach the gospel to every creature. And the first two letters of the word gospel are go. Y'all with me? Hey, I'm pretty excited this morning. Y'all hang on. I had a first diet Dr. Pepper I've had in a long time. And y'all in trouble. All right. Psalm 126:6, it says, "He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him." And the word's supposed to go, go. Acts 5:20, by the way, nothing's going to happen till we go. It says, "Go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." Jesus said it and Jesus did it. Amen? Y'all with me? Hello? Oh, you weak this morning. Hang on. We're going to get better. Mark 1:38, and he said unto them, "Let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also. For therefore came I forth." Mark 5:19, when Jesus cast the demon out of the man, he says, "Go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath had compassion on thee." Matthew 13:3, and he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, "Behold, a sower went forth to sow." So, let's went. What do you mean? Many used to be in the habit of witnessing, but their got up and go has got up and went. And we need to went again, right? We've just got to go. Go and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Y'all with me this morning?
Amen.
Okay, I'm just making sure. Everybody's like, "Man, he's just gone nuts." Football game. They're at the home field, right? The home team was getting just beat to death. And I've given this before. Some of y'all may have heard it, but I love it. And there's a crowd started to chant, "Send in Calhoun! Send in Calhoun!" Well, sure enough, the game kept going and it got worse. Man, the score was bad. They were just getting pummeled. The crowd for the second time says, "Send in Calhoun! Send in Calhoun!" And they wouldn't. And so the third time, the whole stadium says, "Send in Calhoun!" And the players turn around and says, "Calhoun don't want to go in." But there's a lot of us. Listen, there's a lot of Christians that way. Amen? God says, "I'm sending you. I'm sending you into the game. I have left you here for that purpose." And there's many Christians who don't want to go. They don't want to get in the game. Luke 10:1-3 says, "The Lord sent them two and two before his face into every city and place, whither he himself would come. Therefore he said unto them, 'The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few.'" Here's what we're supposed to do though. Here's the command. Pray, therefore, ye the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into the harvest. He says, "Go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves." You say, "Wow. I don't like that last part." But he promises to watch out for us and care for us like a shepherd would. Amen? John 15:16, "You've not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit." I want to ask you a question, my friends. How many people have you actually invited to church in the last year? How many people in your lifetime have you had the privilege of leading Christ? Well, Brother Don, that's the preacher's job. Yes, because I'm a Christian, and so are you. Well, how about this one? Luke 15:4 says, "What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he finds it?" Here's another one, Romans 15:25. "But now I go into Jerusalem to minister unto the saints." Galatians 2:9, "We should go unto the heathen." That's what it says. Acts 28:26, "Go unto this people and say, hearing ye shall hear." Acts 8:29, "Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot." Finally, you look at our text, it said the servant came home and showed the Lord these things. What things? That the people that had already been invited said no, they made excuse. And he says, well, go into the highways and hedges, compel them to come in. And I want to ask you a question. When we invite someone, do we just say, well, I don't know if you want to come to my church or not, but it'd sure be nice if you came over, if you came to my church. Yeah. I mean, is that how we invite folks? Is that compelling someone to come in? Right? Now, how about if you ask somebody on a date? Remember, how many of y'all remember when you dated? No one. Two. Okay. I was going to say, and bless their hearts, it's the oldest two in the congregation. We're in bad shape. We can't remember. Well, Jane's not. Okay. Anyway, when you're dating, when you ask somebody on a date, well, you probably wrote them a note to school. Will you go out with me? Yes or no? Circle one. Y'all ever write those notes? No, man. I know how it goes. Now, here's the thing. I want to ask you a question. When you were asking for a date, did you go, I don't know if I'm going to go with you or not. Now, some of you may, and she may have felt sorry for you and gone out with you. And that's how I got my wife. But, you know, when you ask somebody to marry you, right? It's almost like a grand gesture these days. You just can't ask them to marry you, man. You've got to set up this big elaborate thing so everybody knows what's going on, right? Why? Because that's good news if she says yes, right? If she says no, you're in trouble. But the thing about it is we have the best news of anybody, anywhere, at any time, and we are so quiet about it. When we ask, when we go, are we compelling them to come in? Well, how do you compel someone to come to church? Well, you keep asking them. Tell them what all God's doing at your church. Say, God's not doing anything in my church. Well, find one that is. Amen? Friends, in most cases, the word that's translated go is in what's called the present progressive tense. How about that, English teachers? And it literally means as you're going. So as we go place to place, as we go over and over, as we go to all these different places, all about our business, as we are going, we're to compel people to come in. Not just the church, but to the kingdom of God. Amen? We're to compel them to come. And by the example and by the light that we show, that should give them a thirst because we're the salt and we're the light. And they ought to desire to come in. Friends, but we need help, we need structure, we need a plan. And that's what this church gives you today. Why did God leave us here instead of taking us away on salvation? Well, in order for us to take as many with us as possible. That's that simple. Somebody say, what's your goal in life? Is it to make a lot of money? Oh, no. At one time it was. Money's okay. It really is. And money's good. You say, money can't buy happiness. It can buy a lot. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. I found out a long time ago, it's not about money or things. It's just not. My wife and I, somebody says, what'd y'all do for Valentine's Day? You know, my wife wrote me a very nice Valentine's card. Did you do anything for her? No. Hang on. Stop. You're ruining it. Anyway, last Christmas, against my better judgment, we actually purchased a vehicle. It was a new car. And that was, it's the first new car we've had in, what, 10 years? And so that's her Christmas, birthday, Valentine's. You know, that's all the presents she's going to get for the next 5 years. Yeah. 10 years. Yeah, it has a 10-year warranty on it. So, yeah, 10 years. No. For our anniversary, yeah, we enjoy one another's company and such, but we'd rather enjoy each other's company. That, you know. And again, some of you are a little different. Some of you say, well, you're just not very romantic. Well, I understand. But the thing about it is, is that, is that we don't have a great deal in mind to be the richest people in the world. You know what I'm saying? What God gives us, we use. You know, I've been able to help folks take a trip in this little car. We've taken different trips over to the east of Tennessee and help out some a friend of ours, and we take folks places and do things. Everything we have is at God's disposal. It really is. But the thing about it is, it's not only, you say, well, what is your goal in life? My goal in life is first and foremost to be in the dead center will of God. But the second part of that is, not only in the center of God's will, but I want to take as many people to heaven with me as I can. And I talk to everybody I can. And somebody says, yes, I might come to your church, or no, I probably don't come to your church. And that's okay. But I carry the gospel too. And I ask them, I said, you know what? I said, do you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? That's a whole lot different thing than asking, are you going to heaven? Because 85% of the people in this country believe they're going to heaven. They just don't, they're just not going the right way. It's go time, friends. It's time for us to stop sitting still and time for us to go walk. And it all starts in our Sunday school hour at 9:45. At 9:45, we have the best opportunity to meet, to greet, to bear one another's burdens, to have these little small groups called Sunday School. And it's an opportunity for us to kind of get in on the entry level and figure out, man, this is a great time to be in the Lord's house. Now, it's interesting. We've got a great thing going here at this church. And I believe it's time we share it with our community. And I want to ask you, is the purpose of the fire company, the guys in the firehouse, they're always out washing them trucks, man. I tell you what, they're washing, they're polishing, they're doing all of that. Is that the whole reason why they are hired to be firemen? No. Their reason is to put out fires. And we need both. They need to take care of the equipment. And there must be a balance between reaching souls and caring for saints. But the point of the matter is, we, I believe, have gotten too far over in taking care of so many saints that we have done it to the neglect of bringing souls to Christ. And I say, it's time to go. Let's go. So let me get to the outline part. Ready? Y'all ready to take notes? Here we go. Number one, let's go and invite them. Let's go and invite them. If you go back to our text, there was a certain man made a great supper. He invited a number of people. Friends, we need to go get them. We need to go out where they are and bring them in where we are. But who shall we get? Who are we going to get? Maybe it was the poor like blind Bartimaeus. Maybe it's the rich like Zacchaeus. Maybe it's the religious like Nicodemus, or the sick people like the impotent man, the wicked people like the woman at the well, or the black people like the one of the Ethiopian eunuch, working people like James and John who were mending their nets, political leaders like Cornelius, the social people like Lydia, the little people like children Jesus spoke of, red, yellow, black, white, whoever they are, we need to reach them all.
Amen.
And by the way, I'm here to tell you, friends, I don't see anywhere in Scripture where God has any kind of a color eye chart for us to follow.
Right.
He says we all are sinners, but we all have the same salvation. We all have the opportunity to have the same salvation. So please, dear friends, dear loved ones, we look at people as souls, not at the color of their skin. It's the very occasion of this parable is Jesus eating with sinners. And remind me of a little joke. A little girl in England came home and said, "Mummy, mummy." You know, they don't say mom, they say mummy.
Mum, mum.
She said, "My name is in the Bible." The mother said, "Edith, honey, your name's not in the Bible." The little girl said, "Yeah, the preacher said, Jesus receives sinners and eateth with them." Her name is in the Bible. I tell you, it's a blessing to know that not only Jesus' name's in the Bible, but so is yours and so is mine if we're saved. Amen? Nowhere does the Bible command the lost to come to church. Did you ever see that? Anybody ever read through the whole Bible? If it was just that there are some churches that will think that the lost ought to come to church. That because of who we are, where we are, location, location, location. Because of what we have, because of all the different programs we have, people ought to just automatically come in the door. I want to ask you a question. When you were lost, was the first thing on your mind to say, I think I'll go to church today? Of course not. And it's still not on people's minds. That's why we need to compel them to come in. We're to go and bring them in. Jesus said in all the world we're to go. Into the streets and the lanes in Luke 14. Into the highways and hedges. And God is leading us to the thirsty people, the seeking people, the interested people. And there are many. The fields are wide unto harvest. I say it over and over and over again. We see all of this mess going on around us. And I want to tell you something, friends. There's a lot of folks out there that are looking for something. And to riot and to do all of those things is that something they're trying to fill in this place in their heart that only God can fill. And the thing about it is how in the world can they know about the Lord Jesus Christ unless we who are saved go and tell them? We can't just sit back and point our finger at them and say, man, they ought to get right with God. They have no idea what you're talking about. They have no idea who God is. You understand that? We must tell them. And if we don't tell them, nobody will. So we need to go and invite them. Number two, we need to go and instruct them. Jesus said, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. So the phase one is to get them. Phase two is to teach them. Training and teaching the ones we've invited. In other words, has anybody ever mentored anybody? Listen, it's not just a Sunday school class. It's not just a class to disciple people. In the old days of Southern Baptist conventiondom, there used to be training union. Anybody remember those terms? Then they called it discipleship training. Right? They don't call it anything because it's not around. The thing about it is, it's not just a class. It's us investing our lives one-on-one with others. It's us investing our lives in others and encouraging them, mentoring them along the way. If I didn't have mentors over the years in preaching and teaching in life, friends, there is no way I would ever be anywhere near where I am today. God sent mentors to me. And that's what we need to do. Invest ourselves in others. Show them we love them. Invest ourselves. And disciple them. Well, number three, let's go and inspire them. Friend, there's a need for Christians to be alive, alert, and awake. Simply because the world is looking for something real. We hear all this out there now called the fake news. How many of y'all can tell the difference between fake news and real news? It's hard to do, isn't it? And I want to tell you, there's fake religiosity and the real relationship with Jesus Christ. And the world's having a hard time telling the difference. And we need to be about the real thing. You say, well, how are we? Because, I believe the message is exciting. The gospel is life-changing and it's eternity-altering. And there's a tremendous need for zeal and inspiration in the world today. And a great church such as this is rare and precious. Are you saying River Rock's a great church? Absolutely I am.
Amen.
It's a great church because God has made us great. You say, are you just getting all pumped up and prideful? No. I'm saying that we love the Lord Jesus Christ in this church. We're going to love you as soon as you walk into this church. And the Bible is the very foundation of everything we do in this church. This is a great church because it is after the things of God. You say, are you saying that no other churches are great? I don't know. It's not my responsibility to go to other churches and tell them whether they're great or not. It is my responsibility to lead this church as God leads me, and for us to follow after the things of God and to be in the center of His will. And because we seek that, this is a great church. It has great people. Why are they great? Because the Lord Jesus Christ created you in His image. And He says, I love you. Great church. Matter of fact, there's no place like this place anywhere near this place. So this must be the place. Amen? There's no place like this place anywhere near this place, so this must be the place. Somebody visiting today says, Brother Don, you're nuts. Welcome to the family. Friends, I believe God's business is the greatest business in all the world. I really do. You say, Brother Don, what were you like before you were a preacher? I was lost before. Then I got saved. And then I found out there wasn't any business better than God's business. I love serving in church. Amen. I did bus routes. I taught little snotty kids. I did, man, and even the grown-up snotty kids. And everywhere in between. And I had a time. I loved it. I was a children's pastor. I've been a youth pastor. I've been a bus pastor. I've done it all, man, and I love it. Say, do you love being a pastor? Most days. Friends, we need to be in God's business. Now, for us to carry a frown and walk around a little stoop with the burdens of the world, and we're like, hey, come to church with me, would you? Right? Why would anybody want to come for that? They've got that already. Amen? I want to tell you, I'm just excited. All right, hang on. We need to get excited about the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to be excited about inviting people to church. We need to be excited about carrying the gospel of Jesus Christ because it makes an eternal difference in their lives. Amen? Number four. We need to go and involve them. Friends, once people are invited to come to Christ and instructed in the ways of the Lord and inspired to do the work of God, it's time for them to get plugged in. It's time for them to get plugged in. You will be assimilated. We have to be ready for what's coming. I mentioned this all the time, but I said, we need to prepare for rain. Remember the story? Facing the Giants. Man comes in, talks to the coach, said, Coach, I believe God wants you here to grow where you're planted. And that man had been praying for a revival in that little Christian school in that movie. And he said, you know what? There's two farmers desperately in need of rain for their crops. One farmer went out and plowed the field, and the other one didn't. He says, now you tell me which one was ready for the rain. And for a while now, we have been preparing for the rain. And I'm saying, let it rain. Amen? Let it rain. Now, many of you may be approached about some opportunities. And here's what I'm asking you to do. Don't turn it down outright. Nah, I'm just not going to. But also don't say, well, if nobody else will do it, I'll do it. You don't know how that's, you know what's going to happen then, right? And you won't do it. Because you won't be allowed to. Truly pray about it. Step out of that comfort zone. See what God can do. There's once upon a time my wife wouldn't speak to a teenager. She thought they were all like going to kill her. I'm serious. And then we had a Sunday school class. We had nines and tens? Ninth grade. Ninth grade. That's the best grade anyway. Anyway, ninth graders, and our class grew and grew, and they learned to love my wife, and my wife learned that they weren't going to, like, kill her. And but the thing is, that was way out of her comfort zone at the time. But they learned to love her, and now she's Mommy Bobby instead of... There are 30-plus-year-old kids, that will still come to my mind, Mommy Bobby, right? Friends, it's exciting. And we need to be in prayer about where God can use you in our outreach program. And we need to expect great things. Somewhere recently, I heard of a tribe of native South American natives, and they had eaten of this tree, and they found out this tree would give them energy and strength. I thought, that's pretty interesting. And they would eat from this tree to keep them from getting hungry, and they began to eat them regularly, and they were strong, energetic, and very seldom got hungry. And a few weeks later, some died. Wow. They did an investigation, true story, and revealed that they had starved to death. The leaves had tranquilized them and tricked them with false drug-like energy. Yeah. You say, what does that have to do about anything? Friends, it's obvious Satan has had great success in getting Christians to be perfectly satisfied with a humdrum routine of going to church, taking part in the formalities of services, carrying on the functions of social ministry, and thinking they are pleasing God. But really, you're dead spiritually. You've starved your souls of the Great Commission. The only way to get back is to get back to the basics of going after people and carrying out God's command. Friends, let's go. It's not the missionary's job, and yes, we're left here to be missionaries. We're to all go. Now, with that said, very quickly before we go into the invitation, I have these little cards that were in the bulletin. Everybody see these? One more friend than before. You say, what does that mean? If you've never had a friend come to church with you before, you'll have one more friend than you ever had before. That's what that means. And this is just a little postcard, and our goal is to invite between now and March 19th. March 19th, Sunday morning, not March 19th, we're going to have a big, big day here, okay? And I don't know what all is going to be involved, but we're going to have a big day. And I'm asking everybody to invite their friends, their family. And what I want you to do, and I had it somewhere. Oh, I know where they're at. Ta-da! Is when you invite someone, I want you to get kind of their name, their address, things like that. We're not going to put them on a mailing list. We're not going to sell them to the telemarketers unless they're really mean to us, okay? But here's what we're going to do. When it comes time, the week before the Sunday, March 19th, we're going to send out a little phone call and a letter and just encouraging them to come and be a part of our big day on March 19th. And we're going to call it One More Friend Than Before Day. You say, why don't you come be my friend? Why? Because I need one more friend than I've ever had before. Right? You say, why are you calling them friends? Friends, I don't want people to be known as, just come and be, right? Come and be a number. We want them to come and be our friend. We want them to come and be loved. We want them to come and know that God loves them and that we're going to love them like Jesus does. That's what we want. Amen? And so, in your bulletin, you can take them and hand them to your friends. These are not in there, but you can come and get these after a while. But it's the friend information, friends information. And we're doing our best to everybody invite at least one. Everybody in this room, if you invited one and got one more person to come, guess what would happen? We would double in size in 1 week. You say, are you just out for numbers? No. I am out to follow the Great Commission. I am out to tell people about Jesus. And I am doing my best to encourage you to tell others about Jesus. I am encouraging you to do your best to compel them to come in. Because I believe in my heart of hearts when they come and see this great people in this great church, they're going to want to stay and hear more. They will.
Amen.
Amen. Now, many of you today say, Brother Don, I am scared to death to invite or talk to anybody strange. You talk to me all the time. Thank you. Right? But the thing about it is I'm normally introvert. You say, you're nuts. No, I really am. It is something that I work on day by day, constantly through prayer. I really do. But I still invite people. I go invite people from Speedway. I'm up at Speedway. They know who I am. They know when to run. And because they know I'm going to invite them, right? But everywhere I go, I try to invite people. Because I want people to come and see what God's doing here. And maybe you need to have that unction. Maybe you need a special touch from God. And in this invitation, would you just come and ask God to give you that? Now, there's some that say, Brother Don, I just don't know if I can invite or not. You cannot invite because you've not accepted Christ as Savior. Yeah, you can invite, but you don't know what you're really inviting people to come and do. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. None of us are righteous, no, not one. The wages of sin is death. The word death there means hell. The best we could do to earn our way to heaven is to earn our way to hell. Brother Don, I don't believe in hell. Just because you don't believe in it doesn't make it any less true. Brother Don, what else? Well, here's the thing, my friends. If you'll confess your sins to the Lord Jesus Christ, believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, the Bible says you'll be saved. Brother Don, it has to be more than that. Yeah. The Holy Spirit is going to draw you to Him. So now I ask this question. Is there somebody in this room? Listen, if you are in need of a relationship with Jesus Christ, you need to come today. But overall, our whole church, I believe, needs to come and pray that we will be a church that is committed to reaching the next one. How will you respond? Father, we love you. We thank you for your